Hi everyone, my name is Patrick Fuentes, and I work on the Chrome OS Developer Relations team. Today, I'll be talking about how Android developers can support users' needs beyond touch. We'll cover why supporting input peripherals is important, basic support for keyboard, mouse, and trackpad, and some key considerations for stylus support. As Android developers, we're used to users interacting with our apps through touchscreens, but there are many other ways users can interact with our apps. As large screen form factors like foldables, tablets, and Chromebooks become more common, users are exploring new ways of using our apps. In fact, when we surveyed users that owned input peripherals for their tablets, we found that about 85% of them said they use their input peripherals more than half the time. Not only is this an opportunity to improve your experience for users, it's also critical for your app to be accessible for users that can't leverage touchscreen to interact with your app. Of course, the way we approach input support as developers is determined by our UI toolkit. We've been talking a lot about Jetpack Compose lately, and we believe it's the way forward for all Android apps. We've been working hard to add top-tier input support to the new UI toolkit, so we'll show how to provide support for each topic in Jetpack Compose as well as in the Android View system. With the variety of input options out there, it's easy to not know about all the opportunities to improve your app's interaction experience. To help shed some light on these opportunities, we'll look at some examples in existing app interfaces, and we'll cover how to update them to make sure there's a great experience for user input. Let's take a look at an account creation screen as an example. If we only use this app on a handset with a touchscreen, things seem fine. However, when we try to use the app on a tablet with a mouse and keyboard, we quickly find that we're unable to fill out the whole form. As a user, when I'm sitting at my desk, I expect to be able to use a mouse and keyboard, so this experience can be really frustrating. Sure, I can remove my tablet from the external keyboard and use the on-screen keyboard, but not every user will do that. The experience is even worse when I try the app on a Chromebook that doesn't have a touchscreen available. In this situation, the user could be prevented from even creating an account. Thankfully, adding basic support for a mouse and trackpad can be as easy as a dependency update. As of release 1.2, Alpha 2, Jetpack Compose supports clicks and scrolling with all these peripherals for free, and the Android View system has included similar support for years. In this example, all we have to do is update our dependency to the latest version, and we've resolved the problem. Simple mistakes like this can be avoided by testing your app with a keyboard and mouse. You can even do this using peripherals attached to an Android phone if you don't have a tablet or Chromebook available. If users can't enter text appropriately with an attached keyboard, it's best to find this right away and address the issue, so don't let these problems slip past you without testing. While we're testing that our app works with a hardware keyboard attached, it's a great opportunity to ensure that layouts appear properly with either a virtual keyboard or an attached physical keyboard. The presence or absence of the virtual keyboard on the screen makes a big difference in the window available to our app. We want to make sure that we're prepared for the difference. We won't cover everything it takes to have an adaptive UI in this talk, but you can learn more about how to adapt your app's UI across different screen sizes and orientations in another Google I/O talk this year, Implementing Android Apps for All Screen Sizes. While we're testing out basic interactions, let's cover one last topic, text selection. Being able to select text is something many users expect, but not every app supports it. Text field composables and edit text views handle this for us. However, this isn't the default behavior for their uneditable counterparts. Fortunately, making displayed text in Jetpack Compose or in a text view selectable can often be addressed easily by adding a line or two of code. Once we have the basics taken care of, let's take a look at some opportunities to improve the quality of our interactions. For users with a physical keyboard, keyboard shortcuts can make a huge difference in usability. Keyboard shortcuts to cut, copy, paste, and more are supported by default in EditText and Jetpack Compose's text field, but you should still test to ensure that common keyboard shortcuts work with your app. While some common keyboard shortcuts for text manipulation are handled for us, we should also look for opportunities to implement keyboard shortcuts that are more specific to our app. different apps benefit from different kinds of shortcuts. For example, in a note-taking app, a user may expect to use Ctrl-O to open an existing note. Fortunately, we can add support for Ctrl, Alt, and Shift keyboard shortcuts and a handful of lines of code by overriding dispatch key shortcut event. Once we've intercepted the shortcut, opening an existing note is easy since it's something that we're already doing in our app. Another common expectation from users with a keyboard is that the Enter key performs an action where appropriate. For example, when I'm typing in a chat app, I expect the Enter key to submit text I've typed. Or when I'm typing in a search field, I'd expect the Enter key to submit my query. If we're using an edit text, this is as simple as setting an on-key listener and intercepting Enter key events. In some situations, we may want to catch events as soon as the key is pressed or repeatedly. However, in most situations, we only want to listen for the action up key event. So that's what we'll do here. If you're using a text field in Jetpack Compose, supporting keyboard shortcuts is very similar to implement. You can add the on preview key event modifier to the text field and listen for the key up event from the Enter key. Similarly, as a user, I expect pressing the Escape key to dismiss focus from the text field that I'm typing in. Escape to dismiss is implemented the same way, but we intercept the Escape key instead. Then we call the local focus manager to clear focus. Now that we've looked at how to handle key presses appropriately, let's explore one last area related to keyboards, navigating on-screen elements. Being able to navigate the elements on a screen with the tab or arrow keys can make a huge difference for how your users experience the app. Of course, we want to create products that are inclusive for all users, and proper keyboard navigation support can mean the difference between whether or not our app is accessible to the many users that depend on it. Thankfully, providing a great experience doesn't always require a ton of work. I like to think of navigating on-screen elements with three questions. Can users reach every element they need to? Are those elements in the right order? And is the navigation efficient? The most crucial aspect of keyboard navigation is to ensure that users are able to reach every element they need to. The best way to validate this is to try to navigate your app's interface with a hardware keyboard. If you find that you're unable to reach an important on-screen element, you'll want to ensure that it's set to be focusable and the element in question isn't contained in a parent that's preventing it from gaining focus. The team is working hard to add more seamless input support to Jetpack Compose, and that includes focusability. For example, we just recently added support for moving focus in a lazy list, so always make sure that you're using the latest version to take advantage of these improvements. Updating your dependencies could resolve issues related to focus and more. As we're testing to ensure that each interactive element is focusable, we'll want to ensure that those elements are also navigated in the right order. To do so, simply use the tab or arrow keys to move focus around your application and look for any instances in which the focus moves in a way you don't expect. Focus traversal often behaves as we'd like, so we won't normally need to change our code. However, if you find an issue and you want to change the order that views are focused in, you can do so by specifying the next element to focus on should be for a given element using the Next Focus Forward attribute for views. In Jetpack Compose, you can change this by assigning references to your composables and using the Focus Properties modifier to specify the focus traversal order. To ensure that navigation is efficient, we need to confirm that views that don't need to be focused aren't focusable. If a user can't interact with an on-screen element, including it in the set of focusable elements forces users to do extra work to navigate the screen. To eliminate this friction, we can set focusable to false for views, or by setting can focus via the focus properties modifier in Jetpack Compose. We can also leverage attributes on view groups like screen reader focusable for intelligently grouping on-screen elements. This can help keep your keyboard navigation efficient when you want to build a single interactive element out of multiple views. Of course, keyboards aren't the only common input peripheral. When a user has a mouse or trackpad attached to a device, we introduce an on-screen pointer. The most important consideration when a pointer is used with your app is what hover states you provide. Giving interactive elements hover states can provide your users with a polished intuitive, and informative experience. While some elements, like buttons, provide hover states by default, you should ensure that interactive elements in your app have appropriate hover states. When adding hover states, we don't want something that emphasizes each component too much when it's hovered over, but subtle hover states can communicate interactivity to users. For Android views, we can add an on-hover listener and change the view's appearance when we detect that the pointer has entered or exited hovering. In most situations, all you need to do to add a hover state to a composable is simply add the clickable modifier. This is because, by default, making an element clickable in Compose adds a hover state. If you want to add a hover state to a composable without clicks, you can use the hoverable modifier and set an indication modifier on your composable when the item is hovered. There's one last kind of input peripheral that I'd like to highlight, the stylus. Android users have had styluses for years. But as users embrace new large screen form factors like foldables, tablets, and Chromebooks, styluses are becoming even more important. As with any other kind of input, the main thing to do to prepare your app is to test it with a stylus. If a stylus user is unable to click or scroll, they're not going to have a great experience with your app. Many apps can benefit from allowing users to write, draw, or erase with a stylus. Of course, you can do more than simply drawing with this kind of input hardware if it's appropriate for your app. For example, consider adding support for users to select or move objects using their stylus. If you're providing users with opportunities to use a stylus for input, be sure to test that palm rejection works well. In many cases, this will work automatically out of the box. However, if you're directly handling motion events for drawing or for something like a game, make sure to interpret action cancel correctly, as this may indicate a gesture was an accidental finger or palm stroke. For situations where users are most likely to use stylus input for your app, you may want to interpret all non-stylus input as accidental or as a secondary type of action. For example, many drawing apps will assume users are drawing with the stylus when stylus input is being received and assign finger touches for panning or zooming, or for selecting and moving objects. When you add stylus support to your app, be sure to check out the low latency stylus library on GitHub to ensure the best possible user experience for your app on Chrome OS devices. In the repository, you'll find a sample that shows both the CPU-driven and the GPU-driven approaches to optimizing stylus support. The sample also demonstrates prediction configuration and offers a side-by-side comparison with and without the low-latency library. Robust stylus support doesn't make sense for every app, but it's a big win for user experience in the right app. Even if focusing on stylus support isn't right for your app, there are likely other ways to delight your users with thoughtful input support. The most important thing to do is try your app with a variety of input peripherals and think about what hero use cases make sense in your specific context. Every app has unique needs and opportunities, and you're best equipped to find them for your app. For example, an app that accepts content like images or files should support drag and drop, or a video player should ensure that it supports media keys. These changes can take your app's user experience from frustration to delight. That's all for today, but be sure to check out the wealth of new or improved documentation available to you on developer.android.com, material.io, and chromeos.dev. I particularly recommend checking out the new guidance from the Material Design team on supporting input. It covers the most pressing things to consider for supporting the most common kinds of input devices. As always, thanks for listening. And if you only take one thing away from this talk, please try your app with a keyboard, mouse, trackpad, or stylus today. There are many affordable Chromebooks and large-screen Android tablets, and we can't wait to see what your app can do with them. Thank you.